and welcome back to the 8-Bit Guy. So, I'm sure you guys have seen this little TV in a lot of my episodes. I've been using it for years, and I've actually had this in my possession since 1997. And I have a little story to tell you about that. I was actually working at AST Computer. I worked in the tech support department, and I actually have a lot of stories about that. And I actually hope to compile some of those little anecdotes for a video at some point. But one of the things that actually happened around 1997 is that AST was having some financial problems, and they were actually being bought out by Samsung. And one of the things Samsung wanted to do to help enlist the trust of all their newly acquired employees was to give them all a gift. And we had the option of receiving either a little TV like this one, or a VCR, or a microwave oven. I actually opted for the TV, and it's actually been a really fantastic little TV. Now, I want to point out that when I first received this, it was 1997, and I was 22 years old, and I was living in a one-bedroom apartment with my newly married bride. Well, at the time, we didn't have a lot of money, and this actually became our bedroom TV, and we actually watched TV on this. I mean, this little 13-inch TV, it's hard to imagine, but this is actually what we watched TV on every evening for probably a couple of years. So for the last 15 years or so, this has become essentially just a monitor for me. I don't really use the TV part of it anymore. In fact, I couldn't even if I wanted to, because analog TV doesn't exist anymore. But it makes a really good little composite monitor for hooking up to a Commodore or a Nintendo or an Atari or something like that. And but it has been brought to my attention repeatedly over the last several months that it is actually possible to mod consumer televisions like this to display an RGB signal, specifically an analog RGB signal. Now, why would I want to do that? Most every computer made since the late 1980s has either supported some sort of RGB video signal, or just flat out required an RGB monitor. However, there are a variety of different standards. So the Amiga, for example, used this 23-pin connector, and the Apple IIgs used this 15-pin connector. IBM CGA and Tandy machines used a 9-pin connector. And of course, VGA is also a type of RGB signal as well. An RGB signal typically consists of three separate wires carrying the red, green, and blue signal. There's also typically a sync signal and a ground. Of course, any color CRT television has to break the signal into RGB at some point, because that's how it's delivered to the back of the cathode ray tube. However, that's a high voltage signal at the back, so ideally you'd want to feed the RGB signal somewhere on the low voltage part of the board. So let's take this one apart and see what we can find. Okay, this is all pretty standard stuff for a TV from this era. First thing I'll want to do is discharge the tube. This spring appears to be connected to the DAG ground, so I'll attach my alligator clip to that. And I'll attach the other end to a screwdriver, and I'm not really expecting anything since this has been powered off for days, and most TVs from this time have a discharge resistor. And yep, there's nothing. I'll go ahead and remove the suction cup. And now I'll just need to start unplugging things. I'll start with the tube itself. And eventually the board will come out. This thing's a bit dusty. I'll go ahead and hit it with some compressed air. Okay, so looking at this board, there are only two chips we need to focus on. One is this microcontroller. This chip drives the on-screen display, tunes channels, listens to the remote control, etc. This other chip here is what is commonly referred to as a jungle chip, and almost every TV from this time period has one. And this chip does most of the signal processing. Now, one of the things the jungle IC does is to take the composite video signal and then decodes that into RGB and outputs it to the high voltage part of the TV. However, it also accepts a direct RGB signal from the microcontroller for the on-screen display. But in order to know when to switch to that, there's another line called a blanking signal, which the microcontroller will output when it wants to use the screen. So what we need to do is tap into this RGB signal here, and take that to the back of the TV. And then we need to locate 5 volts somewhere on the board and run that to a switch at the back of the TV that we can use to force the blanking signal whenever we want, so that the RGB signal will override everything. There's still one piece of the puzzle left. You still need to get sync from somewhere. Well, we can just use a regular composite input for that, because the jungle chip is designed to overlay the RGB on top of an existing signal. So we'll still be looking for the sync signal from the composite input. Okay, so that's the rough explanation of how this works. Now, I'm not going to go into great details about resistor values and stuff like that because every single TV is going to be a little bit different. Analog electronics is not exactly my strong suit. I actually got a lot of help from a guy named Mark Cohen who looked up the schematic diagram for my particular TV model, and he actually helped me figure out which resistor values I needed for mine. Now, let's get to modding. One of the first things I'm going to do is place a jumper wire across this resistor. And I'll be honest in that I don't fully understand why I'm doing this, but I was told it would improve the picture quality. And this has something to do with the closed captioning circuit where it dims the background around the text, and apparently we want to turn that feature off, and that should do it. Now, these three resistors here are the red, green, and blue lines, and their purpose is to lower the voltage coming from the microcontroller to the correct input voltage for the jungle chip. Now, what we need to do is add another three resistors in series to these, like this, and then we want to run our external lines in between them, like this. So the way I'm going to do that is I'm going to heat up the legs on one end of these resistors and pry them out. And then I'm going to straighten the leads on them. I'll use some desoldering braid to soak up the solder and open those holes back up. Then I'm going to take these three new resistors and I'm going to put those in the same holes, like this. And then I'll solder in those resistors from behind. And so what I've done is connected the resistors together in three little triangles and soldered the wires to the top of the triangle. And I'm putting some heat shrink on just to make sure they never touch each other. And there we go. There was also this unused connector port on the board. I'm not sure what it was going to be, but it has a ground available. So my three signal grounds are going to connect here. And there's also a 5-volt signal in this same unused port. And so I'll connect that to our little blanking switch. And I'll just solder these in from the back. Then we need to connect a wire to the blanking pin on the microcontroller. That's where our 5 volts will go when the switch is turned on. It's pin 25 on this chip, so I'll just put some solder on the leg here. And then I'll come back and just solder my wire directly to it, like so. Believe it or not, that is all of the modifications that need to be done to the board itself. So I'll go ahead and reassemble everything for testing. Now I have this really long ribbon cable coming out of the back of the TV, but for the moment, I just want to find out if the TV is still working after all that I did to it. So I'll connect up the Apple IIgs from the composite port, and hopefully the TV doesn't blow up or anything. Well, here goes. Okay, no smoke or anything, so that's a good sign. I did notice the on-screen display is a little dimmer than before, and I think that was to be expected with the mods that were made. But it is still plenty readable, so that's fine. Now let's power on the Apple IIgs. And we have a picture, exactly like it should be. Okay, all good so far. Next, I want to do a quick and dirty hack here to test the RGB. So I've taken the ribbon cable and wired it straight to this 15-pin connector. I've also just tied the blanking wires together. So I'll plug this into the back of the Apple IIgs and let's fire it up. And to my amazement, it worked first try. And the signal is amazingly clear, although my camera isn't cooperating since the polarization is causing a moire pattern on the camera, but I'll try to get some better close-ups later. But for the moment, I'll just run through these colors to make sure everything is correct, and it is. I'll also set it to 80 columns for a quick test. Typically 80 columns on a television is unreadable. However, it is very readable here. Again, I apologize for the moire pattern, but you'll get some better footage later. So what I need to do now is figure out where in here I can mount my connectors. And I want to mount this switch and these three RCA jacks. And the trouble is, if you look back here, there's a lot of stuff potentially in the way. And I definitely don't want to have the wires or back of the jacks bumping into these heat sinks or the flyback or anything else. So now there's actually space on the side of the monitor, but I don't think that would be particularly elegant. So I think I'm going to put them up here. As always, I'll put down a piece of masking tape to mark my holes. That way if I mess up, I can just put a new piece of tape on there. I like all my stuff to line up nicely, so I'll start with a straight line. Then I'll mark four spots that are 15 millimeters apart. And then I'll use a tiny drill bit to mark a pilot hole on each one. After that, I don't need the tape anymore. And then I'll drill the larger holes. And, as you can see, perfect fit. Okay, so I've mounted the RCA jacks and toggle switch, and since I was not able to find any colored RCA jacks in time for this video, I'll just add a little label here for that. And this switch, of course, will enable or disable the RGB input. Now what's left to do is solder wires to all these things. And so skipping forward a bit, I'm just about finished with that. Now, this is an entirely separate ribbon cable, so my plan is to place an IDC connector at the end of this ribbon coming out of the TV. And the goal is that I want to still be able to remove the back cover of this TV without having to desolder stuff, so I need a way to disconnect things. And so I thought adding this connector would work well for that. Unfortunately, I ran into a problem on the other side. I thought I ordered a pack of male and female IDC connectors for ribbon cables, but the male connectors ended up being for PCB mounting, not for mounting on a ribbon. And I didn't even notice that until just now. You see, I was thinking these would be just like the female versions where I could put the ribbon cable in. And since it could take several days to get these ordered, I decided to take a shortcut for now. I'm just going to plop one of these little guys here on my quad hands, and then I just soldered all the wires directly to these pins. And then, to make sure these don't contact anything inside the TV, I'll coat everything with hot glue. Now, I did order the correct replacement part, which I'll have in a few days, but for now, this should work. And so as you can see, I can now take the two halves of the TV and connect them together, like this, before I reassemble everything. And now, I'm going to need four RCA jacks I can connect to my Apple IIgs. And I'm still going to use this little prototyping connector for the moment as it's fast and easy, but ideally at some point I want to properly build a permanent cable for each of my systems. And here's another annoyance. This cable set was originally advertised as being several feet long, and it's actually really short. Originally I planned to cut it in half so I could use it on two systems, and now it looks like I'll just need to cut these off at the end here. And so, now I've wired all these into the video connector. And on the other side, I have red, green, blue, and sync. So I can go ahead and plug these in here. And the sync actually goes in the original composite port. Pity the cable didn't have a yellow plug to match. Okay, let's try this again. Okay, on first try, I got nothing at all. But then I thought maybe I mounted the toggle switch upside down. I have been known to do that. So let's flip it the other way. And try again. Yep, it works. Okay, so let's try some games. Wow, this looks really amazing. I want to show you some comparisons with composite mode, so I'll flip the switch back to composite and check out the difference. It's probably more noticeable on a close-up, so we're still in composite, and look how much cleaner it gets when I flip to RGB. So let's try another game. So again, we're in RGB now, and here's composite. Let's zoom in a bit. Here's composite, and now back to RGB. So let's try this Tandy Color Computer 3. It has a funky RGB port on the bottom, so I constructed this little cable for testing, and I could probably make something more elegant later. So let's give it a try. And it works! So again, let's do some comparisons. I'll switch to composite mode, and the text is much harder to read. And back to RGB. So let's try a game. Wow, this looks great. I've never seen a Tandy Color Computer connected to RGB before, and it looks like a whole different computer. It's really amazing. So here's another comparison, and let's switch to composite mode, and back to RGB. Okay, well, how about this Tandy 1000? It's designed for a digital RGB monitor, so it does require some slight modification to the signal to convert it to analog RGB. Just to help you visualize the difference, if you looked at an analog RGB signal through an oscilloscope, it would look something like this. And by varying the voltages, almost an infinite number of colors can be created for any given pixel. And that's what we've been working with up to this point. But what would digital RGB look like? Well, by its nature, digital is either on or off, a 1 or a 0, so it would look like this. However, this setup would only allow a combination of these 8 colors to be produced. So, what they do in this case is they add an extra pin into the mix called the intensity pin. And by using this extra pin, it doubles the number of colors by creating brighter versions of each color, thus giving you a total color palette of 16 colors. And that's how CGA video works. So you need some extra circuits to convert a signal like this to analog. Fortunately, I have this little prototype device here from Tekselec, which will do just that. So I'll just plug in my RGB cables and let's fire up the Tandy. And check it out, it works. Now there's some overscan, but I'll deal with that in a minute. Now the Tandy also outputs a composite signal, which you're seeing now, so let's put it back to RGB mode. Yeah, the difference is quite remarkable. So how do we get rid of the overscan? Well, this TV has a secret service menu that you can access. The service manual tells you the code to press on the remote, And here it is. There are a variety of adjustments I can make in here. And, as you can see, I can move the picture around and make it smaller. And so I'll try Planet X3 in CGA mode. It looks good. Next I'll try it in Tandy mode. It looks good there too. Well, the Commodore 128 uses the same type of monitor as a Tandy when using the 80 column display, so let's try that. And there we go. And it's definitely readable. So let's find something with some color. I mean, I guess I could have booted up with Geos, but it's all black and white anyway. So, this is great. I wish I had known about this years ago. I wanted to try one more thing before concluding this. I wanted to try a game console, and I chose the Sega Genesis because it has a standard DIN socket on the back, which was easy to just poke some wires into for a quick test rather than to build an appropriate adapter. Now, the thing is, the Genesis has a pretty good composite output already, but RGB does gain some additional clarity. For example, look at this yellow text here on this blue background. Now, when I switch to composite mode, you'll see like a black outline that isn't supposed to be there, and that's an artifact of composite video. And when I switch it back to RGB mode, you can see that it's gone. Now, this is going to be more noticeable in areas of sharp contrast. For example, looking at the edge of this tree in composite mode, you'll see that it has that same artifact, but when I switch it to RGB, it'll be gone. However, when looking at soft colored graphics like these, there isn't a lot of noticeable difference. And although nearly every game console supports RGB video, I don't think you'll get as much of an improvement as you will with a computer. Mostly because a computer is going to have a lot of text and sharp contrast on the screen, where a game console won't.
So personally, I am really amazed by this mod, mostly because how easy it was to do. And you know, I'm sure the people in Europe probably aren't too terribly amazed because all of their TVs from that time period had the SCART connector on the back, which does essentially the same thing. Well, SCART connectors are nowhere to be found in North America, so this is far more useful to someone who lives in North America. Now, I'm sure a lot of people are going to be wondering why I didn't put BNC connectors or a SCART connector or something like that on the back of my TV. And I certainly could have. I mostly just wanted to use the stuff that I had available at the time, but if you decide to mod your TV, you can use you know, whatever connectors you want on it. Myself, I'm just happy that I was able to essentially double the usefulness of this little TV without sacrificing any of its original functionality. And the other thing I wanted to tell you is it should, in theory, be possible to run a VGA card on this TV. And you might be thinking, well, the frequency's wrong, but many VGA cards can be programmed to work at 15 kHz, and you can do that either in some Windows applications, or there's actually a DOS TSR that I've seen before that can actually change the frequency of your VGA card down to 15 kHz, in which case you could put that in like your autoexec.bat or whatever, and then you could run DOS games in VGA with this monitor, and it'd probably look pretty good. Anyway, so that about wraps it up for this. I hope you guys enjoyed it, and stick around for the next episode, and thanks for watching.